You good?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Let's drop some database knowledge. So today we're going to talk about hash joins. So you maybe think it's kind of weird to have sort of, you know, getting near the halfway point in the semester that we start talking about hash joins, given that you guys just turned in the first assignment doing a hash join. And so the difference is that what we're going to talk about today and the join algorithm we'll talk about Monday next week is about how to do this in a parallel system, right? So the hash join you guys implemented was like the textbook simple thread, you know, single-threaded simple hash join. There wasn't really anything fancy. So for today, what we're going to talk about is how do you actually implement a high-performance parallel hash join implementation. So we'll talk about at a high level what a parallel hash join is, what are our design goals, what do we hope to achieve. And then we'll spend a little time as we go along, talk about the different components that we would use in our hash join implementation. So we can talk about different types of hash functions, we can talk about different types of hash table implementations, and then we'll have some performance numbers from the paper you guys read that shows a comparison of all these different variants of parallel hash joins. So unlike other lectures we've had in this class where we sort of are very hand wavy or ignore sort of the benchmarking numbers that they have in the paper, a lot of times for more complex things, it's hard to really do a good evaluation because it's a lot of work to implement sort of one idea, and it's be very difficult to have a whole new architecture to implement the other idea. So in the case of like the hyper-morsel task scheduling stuff from last class, there's other approaches, but it'd be very difficult for them to re-implement all that in their system to do an apples-to-apples comparison. But in the case of join algorithms, and other types of things, we actually, since it's not that much work to implement a hash join in a system, we actually can do an evaluation on a single system and have sort of a deeper evaluation about the trade-offs that we can make when we implement these things. Okay, so the sort of goes without saying, but the hash join is probably the most important operator you can have in a analytical database system. By far, it's the one that is used the most often, and systems usually spend the most time computing on, right? And especially in a main memory system where we're not worried about fetching things from disk anymore, and if we're on a single node system, we're not worried about the network, then most of our time is going to be spent in the hash join. So therefore, it's really important for us to come up with a real efficient implementation of it. And so going beyond what you guys implemented in class, we want to now talk about how do we actually take advantage of all the extra CPU cores that modern chips have and parallelize as much of the drudgery of a hash join as we can. All right, and the goal is that we want to have all of our cores be busy so we end up becoming memory bound. Right? They're always just doing work and they can't stream data off the memory controller fast enough. So to give you a motivating example of just how important hash joins is. So this is a study that I had a student do last semester where we took the execution profiles of a OLAP database system and we measured how much time the CPU spent on average in the different operator instances. So in this case here, the database system we used was Cloudera Impala. So I realized that's Impala is a distributed, shared nothing, column store database system. So, you know, it's not a main memory system and it's not a single node system, but we can extrapolate a lot of the ideas that we see in our measurements here. They're definitely applicable to the type of database systems that we're looking at. So for this experiment, basically what we did was we executed the TPCH benchmark, and then Impala would spit out these profile snapshots that would say how much time it's spent in each of the different operators. And for this, we can ignore things like, you know, the amount of time we spent reading things from disk. We ignore how much time we spend moving data around from one machine to the next, right? Because again, the way Impala basically works, it's like it runs on top of HDFS and it has a little shim thing that it installs on the HDFS node. It allows it to stream data out without having to go through the normal HDFS protocol. So that's the way they get better performance. But again, the query plans are all going to be the same kind of stuff that we've been talking about so far. So the five different metrics or different operators we measured were the hash join, sequential scans, the union operator, so like you basically take two select statements and you can union their results together, any kind of aggregation function, and then a sort of a catch-all category, I'll say other, which would include query compilation, code generation, exchange operators, basically anything else that's not included in these other four things. So does anyone take a guess for this, you know, based on what we observed in these profiles, does anyone take a guess like how much time in terms of percentage of the total CPU time was spent doing the hash join? Take a guess. 80%. It's a little high. What's that? 30 is a little low. It's actually 50%, right? Almost exactly 50%, which is kind of cool. So now I realize like different workloads, different queries would have different distributions of these operators. And it's possible that different database systems have different distributions, but I don't think it'd be that far off. I mean, if anybody's watching the video here and from another database company and has a different number than this, you know, email me because I'd definitely be interested. But it's just showing that like 50% of our time in the CPU is being spent doing the hash join, right? The sequential scan is really not that interesting, right? Ignoring disk, this is just reading a tuple. Maybe we do like a predicate pushdown and we can do some filtering early on. But from a computational standpoint, it's not as expensive as this. This is also ignoring the storage space for the intermediate data we have to use for all these different operators. So in the case of the hash join, as we'll see later on, since you can have different phases in the hash join, all of those need to have some temporary storage, whereas in the sequential scan, you just sort of, you read something and you write something out. Same thing for aggregations and all these other guys. So the amount of storage memory you have to use in order to compute the hash join, I also think is much larger than these other guys, but I don't have a good way to quantify that with what we collected. So again, the main takeaway here is that hash joins are expensive. The database system is going to spend a lot of time doing it when you run OLAP queries, so we should try to optimize this as much as possible, because this will give us the most bang for the buck. Another quick observation I'd like to make about hash joins in the context of OLTP systems is that for these specialized OLTP systems, like in Astor or VoltDB, or times 10, for example, they usually don't implement hash join because they don't really need to. So if you think of it at a high level, a hash join is basically the same thing as an index nested loop join, right? A hash join is basically you have some tuple, you probe in the index and see whether there's a match. Now, in the case of you're doing an OLAP query, you're scanning large table segments, so therefore you want that index probe to be very, very fast. In an OLTP query, you're usually only grabbing a small number of tuples, and especially if you're doing a join, or you'll have some one primary key, like the single customer record, and you do a join to find all their order records, and they're not going to have that very many. So in that case here, you probably will already have an order-preserving index that you can use to probe into it to find the few number of tuples that you're looking for. So the reason why a lot of OLTP systems don't need to implement a hash join operator is because they don't need to, because essentially the nested loop does basically the same thing. Right? The difference is in a hash join, traditionally you'll build the hash table on the fly, whereas in this case we have the index already sitting there, and that's why it's fast. So we're not really talking about, when we talk about the hash join in this class, for today's lecture, we're assuming we're doing an OLAP query that's accessing a lot of data. Okay, so the sort of high-level design goals that we're going to have in a modern parallel hash join implementation are two of the following things. The first is that we want to be able to minimize the amount of synchronization that we have to do between our threads as they go through the different phases. All right, and we've already talked about this when we talked about how to do efficient concurrency control. The basic idea is that we want our threads to avoid any kind of latching or locking so that they can proceed in parallel. All right? And we talked about how to do latch-free data structures before. Right? So we know about this. We know that this sucks, and we want to avoid this. What's different now in the case of hash join, sort of building on what we talked about in last class, is that we want to be able to avoid cache misses when we access data. Right? So we want to be able to have all the data that a worker thread needs to either be close by in the CPU cache or on the memory, the DIMM that's right next to it. All right, so we're not really talking about the NUMA stuff for today's lecture, but the basic ideas from the morsel stuff that Hyper did are applicable to what we're talking about here. So the minimizing the CPU cache is sort of different. There's a couple other things we need to be mindful of. So the main factors that are going to affect how many cache misses our worker threads are going to have as they execute an operator are going to be obviously the size of the cache, meaning how much data we can store in it, but also the TLB, the translation look-aside buffer. If you haven't taken an OS course in a long time, I haven't taken one in 15 years. So a TLB is basically a cache that the CPU uses to map virtual memory addresses to physical memory addresses. Because normally, if you don't have this cache, you have to go out to DRAM and get back a giant page table to say, where's the address I'm looking for? So they have a little special area in the CPU caches that allow you to say, this address can be found at this location. And so obviously, we want to avoid, you know, having to go get data that's not close by, but also having to do this lookup in the mapping table that may, you know, out on DRAM, have everything close. And then we also have to worry about locality, and there's sort of two variants of this. So temporal locality would be the thread is trying to use the same data within the same sort of time period, right? You fetch something from DRAM, it's in your cache, and you do as much as you can on it before it gets evicted for the next piece in your cache line. And then spatial data or spatial locality basically means that if you go fetch a cache line that has a bunch of tuples or records in it, you want to apply all the operations for what's in that rather than sort of jumping randomly back and forth. Right? You want your items to be spatially close together in your layout and memory. So the two different access patterns we can be mindful of or be think about in order to minimize our cache misses are what we'll call non-random memory access. So this would be something like if you do a sequential scan and you're executing, you know, you're looking at records one by one, or if you do an index traversal and it's sort of looking at one node followed by another. So the way we want to improve our cache performance of this is that we want to try to cluster as much of the data we need even though it's sort of non-random, we want it to be as close together in a single cache line as possible so that, again, it's one fetch to DRAM to go get what we need. And then sort of related to this, for every fetch we get, we want to try to do as much work on that data as possible. Right? Again, avoiding having to go back and forth to get new stuff. In the case of a hash join, this is considered to have random access because when we do a probe or when we build the hash table, we're hashing things, and it gives us a random location or random slot in our hash table, so we don't have that sort of uniform scan access we would have in this case here. So the way we can improve our cache performance is that we're going to try to partition the data in such a way that, again, we can get as much as possible within a single cache line and to reduce the amount of swapping we have in our TLB. And this is what the hash join algorithms that we're going to look at try to achieve. Okay, so the basic algorithm for any kind of hash join has three phases. And so in the first phase, it's called the partition phase. This is basically you're going to take your input relations, say you're doing a join on R and S, where R is the outer and S is the inner. You want to take the tuples that are in those relations and you want to split them up on some hash key using different cores, different threads, and then so you have discrete chunks that you can then do additional phases on just the partitions. This phase is completely optional. I mean, in the case of you guys, when you guys implemented, you didn't implement this step here, right? You just took the data in a single thread and did the hash join on it. The second phase is required as well as the third one. In the second phase, you do this is where you actually build the hash table that you're going to use to based on the outer relation that you're then probe later on using the inner relation. And we'll talk about how you build hash tables and what kind of hash tables you can use in this process as well. And then in the probe phase, you'll take all the tuple that's in the inner relation, go through them one by one, extract the join key from it, hash it, and then do the probe in the hash table you built on R. And then if you find a match, then you know this satisfies the predicate you're looking up for the join, and then you can emit it as its output. So we're going to go through each of these three steps one by one. And again, be mindful that as we go along, we want to make sure that we're parallelizing as much as possible and avoiding synchronization and avoiding cache misses whenever possible. Okay, so in the first phase, partition phase, again, the basic idea is that we have some large table, and we want to spend some extra CPU cycles in order to split it up so that later on, when we do the additional phases, the data will be local. So this is sort of doing the same morsel partitioning that the hyper guys did for their task scheduling. But this is sort of the general idea of it. But we're also doing this as we do the join operator, whereas in the hyper case, they would do it when the data was first loaded, right? And then it just happened to be that everything was sort of already partitioned ahead of time. So this assumes that you just have a table heap that's spread across memory uniformly, and you're going to scan across it and create these partitions. So this seems kind of crazy, right? It seems like you're going to do a scan over the table once and just figure out how to organize it and put it in partitions. And then you're going to scan it again in the build phase to actually build your hash table, right? But what happens in modern processors is that what we hope to achieve, at least, is that by paying this cost of partitioning, by doing one scan in the beginning, or possibly more scans when we talk about other schemes, it's going to minimize the number of cache misses and TLB misses when we do the future phases. And the cost of going and fetching things from DRAM is so expensive relative to the cost of executing instructions that we're willing to pay this price. And we'll see it later on when we talk about the evaluation, the benchmarks, the difference is actually quite significant. Another thing about partitioning is that it can potentially help for keeping things more load balanced. If you partition in a nice way, that way you can guarantee every single thread is sort of operating on you know, the same amount of data. And you can also avoid having to do any synchronization, because if you partition things ahead of time, then in the subsequent phases, you don't need to synchronize across those threads. Everybody can just work on their one partition. So the partitions are going to contain, we're going to scan our table, split up the tuples up into these output buffers that we're going to call partitions. And then what goes inside these buffers depends on what storage model we're actually using for in our database system. So if it's a row storage system, if it's an NSM system, then we can either just copy the entire tuple from the table heap directly into our output buffer, or if we're a little clever and we recognize that I only need certain attributes or subset of the attributes that I have in my table in the upper levels of the query plan, then I can do an early projection and rip some of those guys out. So this really makes sense if you have a really wide table, say 1,000 tuples or 1,000 attributes, and you only need, you know, 5 attributes to do the join and actual query. When you do this partitioning, you can do the projection and throw things out. In the case of DSM or a column store, this is really easy because you just look to see what you need to do the join, and you only copy those attributes into the output buffer. You also have to include an offset to let you go back to the original table if you need to stitch things back together. Or if you're using the virtual IDs that you can use in some systems, you would sort of include that as well. Because we're going to shuffle things around, and therefore the order that we put the attributes into these output buffers is not going to match up with how they're stored in the actual table heap. So that's why you need to keep the offset. All right, so we're going to ignore this for the rest of the class. Just be mindful of, like, when I say we're going to put tuples in output buffers, it doesn't necessarily mean we're copying the entire thing. So it's not as bad as possibly could sound. Okay, so now to do the partitioning, there's basically two approaches. So the first approach we'll call non-blocking partitioning. And I don't mean non-blocking in the sense of, like, a thread doesn't block on another thread because of a latch or a lock. What I mean by that is that the threads can produce the output to the next phase incrementally, or sort of as they go along. So as we do the partitioning, we would figure out what partition a tuple belongs in, and we can copy it in our output buffers, and it can be immediately used by possibly another thread to start building the hash table. The other approach is called blocking partitioning, and this is where we're going to only materialize the results to the next phase once we're done all of our scans and all of our operations, right? And in the case of the blocking approach, we'll see in a second, you may actually want to do multiple scans over your table to do more fine-grained partitioning. And this is sometimes called RADx partitioning. So sometimes you'll see in the literature, it'll say a RADx hash join, a RADx cluster join, a RADx join, right? It always means this approach here. So we'll just call it the RADx hash join. So we'll go through both of these one by one. So within the non-blocking partitioning approaches, there's actually two further sub-approaches we can use. So again, in the blocking approach, we're going to scan the relation once and generate our output on the fly. So every time we find a match, we figure out what partition it goes to, put it in the output buffer, and then it's immediately available to whoever needs it next. So the first approach is used what's called shared partitions. And this is basically, we're going to have a single global set of partitions with output buffers that all the threads are going to be going to write into. And of course, this means we need to synchronize. We need to use latches to make sure that we don't corrupt the data structure if one thread tries to insert a tuple at the same time as another thread. The other approach is use what I'll call private partitions. I think the paper refers to them as independent partitions. The basic idea is that we're going to have the same sort of set of partitions and output buffers that we have in the shared case, but each thread or each worker thread is going to have their own copy of them. So they'll have their own private little output buffers that they can write into, know that the thread can write into them at the same time, so therefore they don't need to set a latch on anything. And then once they're all done, they'll have another round of threads will come through, and they'll just combine the private partitions from the different cores, the different threads, into the global partition. So you end up with the same sort of state as in the private partition case as the shared partition case. You end up with a global output buffers. But in this case here, we don't have to set latches as we go along, but you have to do some extra copying at the end. So just go through this a bit more detail. So here's our data table. Again, we're ignoring what our storage model is. It doesn't matter. So we'll do that same sort of partition we saw in SQL Server with the row groups. We'll just pick some offset of the number of tuples and assign them to each core. And then for this case here, say we're doing on the join of attribute B. So we will each thread will walk through the tuples one by one and compute the hash on the value of this key per tuple. And then that will tell it what partition it should write into. Right, and this is the shared case, so this is a global set of partition output buffers. So let's say that this thread wants to append a tuple here. We have to set a latch on it before we do this, and to make sure that we don't trip up anybody else. And we can use a spin lock or whatever synchronization primitive that we want to use that we talked about before. In the case of the private partitions, we actually extend the partitioning out to our partitions, or extend the division of the tuples to the partitions. So now when we do our hashing and sort in the output buffers, these output buffers are private to this particular core. And then after that, we do another round of coalescing, where every single core will be assigned some partition group, like P1, P2, all the way to PN. And then they will go into this local storage for each core and just combine them to produce the final answer. Right. So again, we have to spend more work because we're doing a little extra work because we have two phases. We have to do some copying and we have to store the data three times now, right? Because you have the original data, the private partitions, and then the combined partitions. But in exchange, we don't have to set any latches. We don't have any synchronization going on here. So that's the non-blocking cases, right? And again, the key from non-blocking is that as we're generating this, again, some other thread could be pulling this and pulling things out and start computing, building the hash table for us. So radix partitioning is a little more complicated. The basic idea of radix partitioning is that we're going to use multiple passes over the data, potentially multiple passes, where in each pass, we're going to compute a histogram that tells us the number of tuples we would have in a particular partition based on the radix of the hash key. And I'll explain what a radix is in a second. And then once we have our histogram, we'll compute a prefix sum sequence, which I'll explain also in a few slides as well, that are going to tell us at what offset in our output buffer should the partition for a particular CPU begin. And then we scan back through the table a second time and start writing those tuples into those output buffers, right? And if we want, we can do this whole thing multiple times, right? There's nothing in the algorithm says we have to do this once. We could do this whole three-step process over and over again. And the goal of what we want to achieve is that by doing more fine-grained partitioning using this radix method, we want our partitions to end up being the same size as a cat, piece of cat or cache line or some chunk of cache data in our CPU. So that when we go build the hash table, it's one cache fetch and one fetch to DRAM to get the block of data. We blast through it in our CPU, build the hash table, and then never have to use it again. And this again seems crazy. You're scanning the data multiple times. It seems really wasteful. But in practice, it actually turns out to be much better. This originally came up, I think this idea came up in the late 1990s. I don't know. I know Oracle implements this type of partitioning. DB2 uses this in Blue. Impala uses this. I don't know whether the radix partitioning stuff is used in other database systems other than the major commercial ones. Right? You search radix join, and nothing really comes up. All right, so first we've got to discuss what a radix is. The basic idea of a radix is just telling you, it says for a given number at a given position based on its base, right, base 10, base 2, whatever, it gives you the value at that position. So let's say we have an input sequence which runs these numbers. If you want to compute the radix for the first position in the integer, it's just whatever the value is at this slot for the tuple, right? So for 89, it's just 9. For 12, it's 1, 2, so it's just 2. Right? It's pretty straightforward. And if you want the radix for the next position at the 100 position, same thing, 8, 1, 2, 0, 4, 6. Right? And we can do this pretty quickly, pretty efficiently in the CPU. So now, a prefix sum is just a running total of an input sequence. So let's say we have a bunch of numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We're going to generate the prefix sum to be the running total going from left to right for each of these values. So in this case here, at the first position, 1 doesn't have a predecessor, so its value is just 1. But now in the second position, we'll take the next tuple in our input sequence, followed by the previous value in our prefix sum, add them two together, and voila, you get 3. Right? That's all this is. And we just go down the line and compute this efficiently, and we get our running total that way. So now let's see how we're going to use the radix and how we're going to use the prefix sum to do radix partitioning. I think there's a sort algorithm called radix sorting as well, which is sort of based on roughly the same idea. All right, so now let's say we have a sequence of numbers here. So assume that we're hashing the tuple's join key, and we're going to get these hash values. Right? For now, it's a real simple hash, so we only have two numbers. And for this, we're only going to have two CPUs. So we'll have two threads running at the same time. So in the first step, we want to scan through the input data, and we want to construct the histogram that's going to tell us how many tuples are going to be in each particular partition. So we'll divide our tuple space into separate partitions or chunks, just like as we did before, and then we will choose in this first, since it's the first round we're doing this, we'll choose this first radix position for the hash tuples. So as you can kind of see, there's 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1. Right? So this is going to end up being the radix of the hash key for this pass through the data. So now we will go in parallel, each core will go grab one by one each of the values here, inspect this radix thing, and that's going to say what partition it goes to. And then what they're basically doing is they're counting the number of zeros, the number of ones in total, and that gives you the histogram. So that says for this round, partition 0 at this CPU should have 2 tuples, partition 1 should have 2 tuples. For here, it's 1 and it's 3. So then now, based on this, we use the prefix sum of these counts to tell us at what offset the partition at a particular CPU should appear in our output buffer. Right? So it's not really a linked list anymore. It's just a giant byte array that we can write into at any point. So in this case here, using the prefix sum, we would have the partition 0 at CPU 0 starts here, partition 0 at CPU 1 starts here, and so on. So now because the cores, the CPUs, know what offsets they need to start writing tuples in, they don't have to worry about doing any synchronization with any other thread running at the same time. Right? You're pre-partitioning the output buffer space based on the prefix sum of the histogram. So now, in the third phase, the third step, we're going to go back and scan through our input sequence again, or our tuples, and now start assigning them to the particular partition. And as you can see here, since this guy needs to go to partition 0, CPU 1 knows that this is the place I should write this, and nobody else will be writing at the same time. And we just go down the line one by one and keep doing this for everyone. So now what we have is two partitions, partition 0, partition 1. Right? So we could stop here, and this would achieve basically the same thing that the non-blocking algorithms did with their output buffers. But if we want to go and have more fine-grained partitions, we can just do a whole other round of this again. We can recursively apply the same steps to now this input sequence and partition it even further. Right? So you would do the same thing. So now you would choose a different radix position. So now we'll choose the first position. And we just go through one by one and do all the same things. In this case here, this guy spent a little more time because he has more values. and because the distribution is slightly skewed, and we'll see how this can hurt the rate expectation approach later on. We looked at really skewed distributions. So any question about rate expectation? Yes. I'm missing sort of an extra step. It should be like an array here of the actual tuples. You hash them, and then you take the radix of them. So like when this core is doing that first scan to build the histogram, you hash it, then use the radix position. I just, for simplicity reasons, I just showed the raw sort of the hash value after it was hashed.
And the partitions are based on the radix value.
Correct. Yes. All right, so his question is, in this case here, when we use the prefix sum to compute the offsets of the partitions in our output buffer, if the tuple is variable length, then this won't work, right? But if this is why you try to avoid variable length tuples or variable length attributes in your database system. Right, so all integers are going to be fixed length, or all floats will be fixed length, timestamps, things like that. The only thing that's not going to be fixed length are varchars, var binaries, and things like that. You don't really do joins on blobs, right? Var binaries, so that doesn't really matter. In the case of strings, you can just use dictionary encoding. So now instead of having the string, you have a fixed length integer. Right? I absolutely agree. If you didn't have fixed length attributes, this would not work. But since we do, it's worth, you know, there's an advantage of doing compression, not just reducing the amount of data we have to marshal around. We don't have to do extra bookkeeping for this kind of stuff. But that's a good point. Another question over here? Okay. So this is radix partitioning. This is sort of considered the state of the art in some ways for doing hash join in a main memory multi-core system. Okay. So, yes. Yeah.
What's the synchronization cost while you're computing the prefix sum?
His question is, what is the synchronization cost for computing the prefix sum? Insignificant, right? Everyone has to finish, and then you have a barrier that says, I can't compute the prefix sum until all my cores say they're done doing their scan, right? And then what, you're talking a couple bytes of data, right? You can have one thread rip through that, right? It's not a very expensive calculation. So you don't set a latch to compute the prefix sum. It's not necessary. Any other questions? Okay. So we're done the partitioning phase, right? It's optional, so we may not have done it, but chances are we probably did in a modern system. So now we have our outer relation is now spread out into these different partitions, and now we want to have our threads scan through them and build our hash table. So the basic idea is for every tuple you find, you extract the join key, you hash it, and then you put it into your hash table. All right, the key thing to point out, though, is the hash function we're going to use in the build phase has to be different than the hash function we use in the partitioning phase, so that we can sort of have better randomized distribution of our data, right? That we avoid sort of the pitfalls of skew. In the probe phase, does the hash join need to be the same as the build phase or the partition phase? What's that? It has to be the same as the build phase, right? Because it doesn't make sense to hash something to a hash table with a different hash function. You're never going to find any matches, right? So in the partition phase, it's one hash function. In the build and probe phase, it's the same hash function. So as we build our hash table, the sort of main goal we want to have is that we want our buckets, where we're going to store the actual tuples themselves, we want them to be roughly a few cache lines. So again, anytime we have to go do a lookup and go get a bunch of data, we're not marshaling a lot of stuff back and forth from the memory controller. We'll talk about how to do different hash tables in a second, but I want to first spend some time talking about hash functions, because this is sort of ignored a lot of times when you take an introduction database course of like, yeah, you just hash something, and then you don't really understand what the hash function is actually doing. So the key thing to point out about hash functions you would use in a hash join algorithm is that it's not like the SHA-1 or the SHA-256 thing, you know, things that people use to do like encryption, right? We don't care about our thing being computationally difficult to break. The only thing we care about is that we want to be able to compute the hash very quickly, and we want to have a low collision rate. And a low collision rate means that if we have, say, two strings that are distinct, that are different, we don't want them to hash to the exact same value, which can occur. So the modern variants that people use of hash functions are sort of, there's a bunch of them out there, but these are sort of the main three ones that I know about that people use. So we're not talking about like MD5, that would be a terrible hash function, right? These are ones that are designed to be fast and very general purpose. So MurmurHash is, I think just some random dude wrote it. He put it on the internet, and it's designed to be this fast general purpose hashing function. And it's actually used in a lot of things, both research and in industry. So then Google started looking, when the MurmurHash guys started getting a lot of traction about this, you know, better hash function out there, the Google guys started looking at this and started to decide whether, you know, they wanted to switch all their internal implementations of hashing to use the MurmurHash. And I think at the time they started looking at this was they were looking at MurmurHash 2. And so what they decided to do was take a lot of the ideas that they have in MurmurHash 2 and sort of tweak them to make it be more efficient and better for modern CPU architectures. And they make a big trade-off is that they take a lot of shortcuts to help them run faster for short strings, because that's the kind of, you know, key they see a lot of in their applications, in their workload, right? So by short keys, I mean anything less than 64 bytes. And we'll see in a second, they do extremely well for when strings are less than that. And then a few years after CityHash came out, they came out with something called FarmHash. And the idea of FarmHash is it's an improved version of CityHash, but they're sacrificing performance in exchange for having a lower collision rate, right? And we'll talk about why a low collision rate is important later on. But like, think of it basically: if you have two things hashed to the same value, but they're not the same, they're not actually the same thing, then you need to keep track of both of them. And then when you go do a probe, you have to compare your tuple against both of them, and that gets slow. So. This graph here is actually a benchmark I ran last night. So there's this dude on GitHub who wrote his own framework to take a bunch of these hash functions and just in a for loop spin through as fast as they can and see what throughput you can get for hashing different keys at different lengths. So in this evaluation, he had a bunch of other hash functions, but I'm not showing them. I'm just showing the main ones. So the first is the built-in hash function that comes in C++ 11. Then we have the MurmurHash 3, and then Google CityHash and FarmHash. So there's a couple things to point out. I'm not a hash function person, but I know a little bit about them to talk about what's going on. So the first thing you see, a bunch of these spikes here that all these guys have. In the case of the CityHash and FarmHash, they're more pronounced. In the MurmurHash, it's lower, but in CityHash, it's a little bit bigger. And so these basically correspond to when the alignment, when the bytes they're dealing with don't become aligned, right? And the way the algorithms work, they sort of take advantage of having enough data within your sort of cache lines, your registers, to do very quick operations on it. So if you sort of jump to the next word, you sort of lose that performance. The other cool thing to point out here is here you see in the case of CityHash and FarmHash, they do much better up here. But then beyond this point, they can do worse and better, and they oscillate back and forth. So this here corresponds to the 32 and 64 byte length strings that they were optimizing for. So they get to this point here, and they're doing phenomenal. And then beyond that, when you get to 128, 192, and 256, they don't do as well. So this is sort of the sweet spot that Google was shooting for in their implementation of these algorithms, and that's why you see this behavior. So this is just showing in throughput in terms of not the number of hashes they can compute per second, but the throughput of the amount of data they can hash over time, right? So it's in terms of like megabytes. So what's missing sort of from this, though, is actually the collision rate. So this guy's framework doesn't measure, you know, what the collision rate of all these algorithms are. But according to what Google writes, you know, the farm hash guys are giving up performance compared to the city hash, but they're going to have a much better collision rate. And so when you use this when you probe your hash table in a hash join, you actually may end up being faster, even though the hash function is slower. So this was run on one of the database machines one of the machines in our database group cluster. So it's not super high end, but I've run this on other. He has reports on his website, and I've run this on my laptop, and you see roughly the same pattern. Okay, so now that we have a hash function, right, we can pick one of the four things that I talked about in the last slide. Now we want to talk about how we actually implement our hash table. And so the two basic approaches we can talk about are the chain hash table, which is sort of the default way you would build a hash table, and then a more modern variant called cuckoo hashing, or cuckoo hash table. So we're not going to be using the linear hashing or the extendable hashing approaches that we talked about in like an introduction database class, because those hash tables are designed to be built incrementally, right? So like as you insert tuples, you can extend things dynamically as you go along. In our case here for these hash tables, we don't want to do that because we don't want to have to be, you know, every time we build our hash table, we don't want to be resizing things all the time. So typically what happens is the optimizer will select how many slots it should use in a hash table when you do a join ahead of time based on what it knows about the statistics and cardinality of the data itself. Right, so we don't want a dynamic hash table that can resize. We want to sort of use a fixed length thing based on the knowledge that we can gain by observing the data itself. So the chain hash table is sort of the easiest kind of hash table to build. It's basically you have a bunch of slots, and the slots point to a linked list of buckets. And when you hash your key, you figure out what slot it goes to, and then you find a free slot, or you find a free position or space for it in the linked list of the buffer. And the way you handle collisions, that since you're just always adding them to the same bucket, when you want to do a lookup to see whether an element is present, you have to go jump to that linked list of the buckets and then scan all the tuples to see whether you have the thing that you're looking for. So in best case scenario, if you have a completely uniform distribution of your data across all your slots, it's going to be O1 to do a lookup in a chain hash table. Worst case scenario, if all your keys hash to the exact same slot, and therefore it's just a giant linked list of all your values, then worst case scenario, you're O(n). And doing inserts and deletions are the same thing as doing a lookup. So there's not much really talk about here in sort of the diagram. Again, it looks basically like the output buffers that we had before, and these are just linked lists that have slots where we can put in tuples. And again, the contents of the tuples depends on what storage model we're using. So sort of obvious that the key problem that we have in a chain hash table is that if we have things, if we have collisions, we have tuples mapping to the same slot, then we're going to do a bunch of extra work to see whether we actually have the match that we're looking for. So we want to try to avoid this as much as possible. So one way to do this is just to have a really big chained hash table. So the theory basically says that if you have a chain hash table with 2 times the number of slots as the number of input tuples that you have, then you'll have a low collision rate, or possibly none at all. But this is obviously really bad, right? If you have 1 million tuples, then you need a 2 million slot hash table, right? And that gets to be really inefficient. So we want to try to find a better approach. And this is what the cuckoo hash table seeks to solve. So the cuckoo hash table, the idea came out, I think, in 2001. But like I said, now a lot of the newer database systems are implementing this technique. And the basic idea is that we're going to maintain, the basic version of cuckoo hash table is that we're going to maintain different hash tables that are that use a different hash function. So then when we insert a tuple, we would hash it twice, or the number of hash functions we have, we hash it multiple times, and we try to find a free slot in any of those hash tables, and if we find one, we put it in there. If we don't find one, if you find that somebody's taking our slot, then we can steal it, and then we have to reorganize the hash table by moving the thing we evicted to some other location. And so what's awesome about the Cuckoo hash table is that lookups and deletions are always going to be O1, right? Because the record comes in, you hash it as many times as you have hash functions, and if it's not there, you don't have to traverse anything to go look for it. It's either there or not there. To do insertions, that's a little more complicated because we have to do this eviction and rebalancing. So I'm going to go through an example here. So let's say that we have our Cuckoo hash table has two internal hash tables. Again, to you as the outside programmer, the developer, you know, using this Cuckoo hash table, you don't know that there's multiple hash tables, and you don't care. Right? It's sort of abstract away from you. Logically, it's one hash table. So let's say that we want to do an insert on X, and we're at the very beginning of our hash table. We've already pre-allocated all the slots, but it's completely empty. So because we have two hash tables, we have to hash it twice. And again, we have one hash function for the first table and one hash function for the second table. They can't be the same thing. So here, the tuple would hash to these two slots, right? And both of them are empty, so we could put it in either one. But for, let's just say for this case here, we're going to put it in this position. There's no, you know, there's no right way or wrong way to do this from an algorithm standpoint, right? You just flip a coin and pick whatever one you want. So now we want to insert Y. Same thing. We'll hash it twice for two different hash functions. And we see that in this case here, for the first hash table, it maps to the slot where X is already stored. All right, so we don't want to store ourselves there, but we can store ourselves over here because this slot was empty. Right, so in that case, we make a decision where this is not random anymore. We see this slot's taken, that slot's not, so we'll always choose the empty one. So now let's say we insert Z, we hash it twice, we see that it maps to both where the slot on the first table where X is and the slot where Y is on the second table. So now this is a problem, right? Because we don't have a free slot that we can pick. So in this case here, now we'll flip a coin and we'll choose to store it in the second hash table. So what we'll do is we'll evict Y, replace it with Z. Now Z is stored there. But now we need to reinsert Y back into our hash table at some other location. So we'll hash it again, and this time we only have to hash it for this hash table because we know it came from this. If we hash it again with the same hash function, we'd end up at the same location we just came from. So now we'll hash it back over here, but now we see that this is the slot that X is in. So we'll do the same thing. We'll let Y steal it, and now we need to hash X again, but for this hash table, and then it would end up here, and we have our slot. So the insert on Z technically is not completed until we finish all this data moving around. And I'm not talking about how we do this concurrently or do this in a thread-safe manner. There's actually some research done by Dave Anderson here at CMU to have a concurrent Cuckoo hash table that they use in Memcache. We can ignore all that for now, all right? So what's an obvious problem here? Right, cycles, right? Could be the case that X evicted something that then mapped back to where Y and Z are, and Y and Z are located, and we do this all over again. So we have to make sure that when we do this rebalancing, that we don't get caught in an infinite loop. Right? We have to recognize that when we have a cycle. And so we find that we have a cycle, that we have to do is rebuild the entire hash table using a different hash function. Right? So we'll pick a different seed for a hash function and just go through every single slot, every single key, and rehash everything. And the idea is that from a probabilistic standpoint, then that will rebalance things and we won't have cycles in the future. So again, the theory works out that if you have two hash functions, two hash tables in your Cuckoo hash table, that you probably won't need to rebuild the table until at least one of them is 50% full. But if you use three hash functions, then you probably don't need to rebuild it until you have it's about 90% full. Now, and also, this sort of another factor in all this too is how many slots that you could have. You could have a million slots for your tuples, and you probably would never have to have. You probably never get to that 50% occupancy rate. So there's sort of this trade-off between the number of hash functions we use, and that adds some storage and computational complexity to our Cuckoo hash table. But then there's also the number of slots we could have, and that adds storage overhead. So there's all these different sort of parameters that are difficult to get right in your Cuckoo hash table implementation, and this is usually why the optimizer will select these things for you. But in many cases also too, they just sort of pick a default and go with it. All right, so now we have our hash function, we have our hash table, and we built it. So now we can go through and start doing the probe phase. The probe phase is pretty straightforward, right? For each tuple that's in the inner relation S, we'll extract its join key, hash it, and then check to see whether there's a match in whatever bucket we have or slot we have in our hash table that we built on relation R. Right? So if the inputs were, we took the partitioning phase and split things up, then we can have all our worker threads just work on some partition of the data. Right? The hyper guys did this with the morsel stuff. Otherwise, if we're not partitioned, then we have to make sure that we synchronize our scan process or split things up per core for the outer relation as we go along. And that's done, right? That's hash join. So based on all the things that I've talked about so far in the partitioning phase, the build phase, and the probe phase, we can have some basic variants that mix and match the different ideas from them. So we're going to talk about these four here. So the first would be having the no partitioning at all and use a shared hash table. The second one would be a non-blocking partitioning using the shared global buffers. And the third would be non-blocking partitioning with private buffers. And then the last one would be blocking partitioning or the radix partitioning stuff that we talked about. And I'm not going to, we're not going to compare the different hash tables, the hash functions. I don't actually know what Spiros used in the paper. I should ask him. Let's assume they, we can assume that they did a good job, a good faith implementation of a high performance hash function. So this table here actually lays out the different differences between the different join variants that it's talked about, and it shows you whether things are partitioned, how many scans you have to do over the data, how do you synchronize, where the hash table is, and whether you synchronize for the build of the probe phase, right? And this is basically everything we've talked about before. And these are the barriers that I mentioned when we do the partitioning and the private partitioning and the radix partitioning, where you have to wait for all the threads to finish that piece of the computation before you can go to the next step. And that's what I mean by that. And that can just be implemented by a counting semaphore or something like that. Okay, so now let's talk about the evaluation that was done in the paper. So for this, they're using a synthetic workload with two tables with a primary key and a foreign key relationship. So in the outer relation, which we'd use in the build phase, it's going to have 16 million tuples that are 16 bytes each. And then the inner relation that we'll use in the probe phase, it'll have 256 tuples. And we're going to have two different distributions of our data. So we'll have a uniform distribution where for every tuple in the outer relation, it has roughly the same number of foreign key dependencies or foreign key children in the inner relation. And for the highly skewed case, there'll be a hot spot of tuples in the outer relation that have the majority of the children in the inner relation. And for these experiments, they're not doing output materialization, so we can ignore the cost of that. It's just how fast can we compute the join? So in the first benchmark, for this, in the paper, they talk about doing experiments on a Spark Niagara CPU, as well as a Xeon. I'm ignoring the Spark stuff, and let's just focus on the Xeon stuff for now, because that's pretty much the most common sort of server CPU architecture that's out there today. So in the first experiment, we're going to use the uniform data set, and they're running this on a Xeon CPU. I think it's 2010, but it's not a NUMA architecture that we talked about last class. So it's sort of one socket, and it has one sort of set of memory banks, and the cost or the latency of going access any piece of data from any core is going to be the same. So what you see here now is the stacked bar chart shows how much time is being spent in the different phases. And for this, we're going to measure the number of cycles per tuple that gets outputted, because that's a way, it's a better way to evaluate these different approaches in terms of their efficiency and how much time they're spending in the CPU caches. So if you just measured instructions, you would miss the cache misses. So what you see here is the radix partitioning, it's a one-pass radix partitioning, actually performs the best. Again, this sounds crazy because we're scanning the data, at least for the outer relation, we're scanning it three times, right? Twice for partitioning, once and once for the building the hash table, right? And you see the partitioning cost is pretty high for this. Compared to this, and this has no cost. The share partitioning case the cost here has to do with the synchronization primitives. So in that, so they're showing that if you don't even bother partitioning the data, you can still outperform this because they have that, you know, sort of global data structure that they're all writing to. So now when we go looked at the so here in this case here, if we the RAIDX is going to be 24% faster than the no partitioning case, and when you actually measure what's going on in the system, this is going to have 3 times as much cache misses and 70 times as much TLB misses than the RAIDX case. Right, so that's why this probe phase here is so expensive. And this is sort of why the people have argued that you want to use partitioning to avoid this overhead. But now, if you go look at for a skewed workload, what they show is actually the no partitioning case actually performs the best. Right? And the reason what's going on here is, in ignoring this for now, in these two guys, because the workload is the data is skewed, when you create the partitions, some cores are going to have a lot of work to do, and some of them are going to have no work to do. And so the ones with no work to do end up finishing much earlier than the other guys, and they just sort of sit around waiting for the stragglers. So they claim that the work stealing approach that the hyper guys talk about doesn't actually help you in this problem here, because you just end up paying more cost to move data around. Now, they didn't do experiments with the NUMA system to actually measure this, but this is what they claim in a follow-up addendum to the paper that was addressed to the Oracle guys. Basically, what happened was Spiros presented this at SIGMOD. The Oracle guys were sitting in the audience and said, this doesn't make sense, this doesn't match up with what we see, and then they have a follow-up paper that improves this and makes the number a little bit better. All right, and they talk about how work stealing could help, but they didn't measure it. Or they don't think it would help, but they didn't measure it. The shared partitioning case is just because that, again, we have so much work being done. Why is that high? I forget. So everyone's trying to write to the same partition, and therefore that becomes a single bottleneck, and you have lock thrashing. Yeah, thank you. I forgot. Okay, so again, so their basic argument is that in a UMA system, the no partitioning case actually works faster. But if you apply some of the optimizations that Oracle has, and I think also too, if you have a NUMA architecture that your RAIDX thing could be optimized for, I think you can beat this. Okay, so one high level observation about everything I've talked about in this class so far is that I've ignored a lot of decisions you would have to make in your system. So I've ignored the question of should I even partition or not, right? Because clearly we show here that partitioning helps for this type of workload and not so much maybe for this one. So how do I pick this at runtime, whether I should do this or not? I've ignored how many partitions to use. I've ignored how many passes should I take if I'm doing RAIDX partitioning through the data. In a real database system, the optimizer will pick these things for you. So part of when it generates the query plan, when it generates a physical plan from a logical plan, it fills in these parameters for you. It says that I know we have this much memory, I know we have this many cores. This is what I should do. This is how many partitions you should use. For some things, sometimes you just sort of, like in the case of the hash functions in a cuckoo hash table, those things are usually hard-coded. But anything that's more dynamic that depends on what the actual data looks like, the optimizer selects these things. And this is sort of like a well-guarded secret in a lot of commercial systems where they don't tell you exactly how they make these decisions. But roughly, you look at the catalog, look at the statistics, and you say, this is what my data looks like. I'll set a parameter. So now let's look at what happens when the optimizer could get something wrong. So in this experiment, it's the RAIDX partitioning case for the uniform data set. And along the x-axis here, we're going to have different number of partitions to use to split up the data. And we'll have the RAIDX partitioning in one pass, and then RAIDX partitioning in two passes. So in the case here, this vertical line, sort of this horizontal line, represents the best case no partitioning algorithm from the first set of graphs that I showed. So this is showing that the same number we had before, when we have 4096 partitions, we get 24% better than the no partitioning algorithm. But in the two-pass approach, you get 5% worse. So it's the same algorithm, right? With the same number of partitions, but it has dramatically different performance. So now if we do a sweep across all these different parameters, you see that there's sort of like a parabola that goes up and down. So there's sort of this local minimum sweet spot where we want to be. In the case of 4096, they knew that when they did all the other experiments, and that's why they picked it. In the case of the two-pass case, it's not quite that uniform, right? The best case here is actually having 32,000 partitions. So this goes to show that like the performance characteristics you can get for your hash join can be dramatically different based on what the optimizer chooses for its different runtime parameters. And the quality of those choices that it can make are highly dependent on the amount of statistics, the amount of data that it collect about your database. If you have bad statistics, they're stale, then you might end up choosing, 64 partitions and get terrible performance. So they argue in the paper that although the no partitioning hash join is slower in some cases than other algorithms, because you have less knobs, you have less choices you have to make in your implementation, it actually may turn out to be better. Because on the average case, you're not likely to get things wrong. Okay? So one last experiment, I want to show the effects of hyperthreading. So again, they're running on a single socket CPU that has six hardware cores, and then for each hardware core, you have two hyperthreads, or two threads. So what this is showing here is, as they scale up the number of threads they use to compute the join, the no partitioning case ends up scaling linearly, or almost linearly. Look at the dotted line is the ideal case. Whereas the RADx partitioning join actually gets worse when you have hyperthreads. And so part of this is that when you have multiple threads, this will hide all the cache miss latency and TLB misses in your system, but it becomes more pronounced when you get to hyperthreading because you have now two threads accessing the same counter or the same caches on your core. Right? So they're evicting things that the other guy may need. And so although the RADx partitioning, because everything's split up into nice cache line chunks, they have fewer misses and TLB misses. In the end, this ends up doesn't help you when you go into the hyperthreading world. And for the no partitioning join, you just get better performance because there's no synchronization with your threads. They're sort of blasting through data as fast as possible. So again, I'd be interested to see how this would work in a NUMA architecture, whether you see sort of slightly the same benefit, as the same gains you would get with the non-partitioning case. Okay, so to finish up, on modern CPUs, it's important to have a good hash function, or hash operator implementation. The Wisconsin guys argue that the simplest algorithm actually turns out to be the best. All the fancy RADx stuff doesn't really help you as much as you think it should. The one thing we've ignored in all this discussion, though, is there are a bunch of additional optimizations we can apply to the RADx join algorithm that we haven't talked about. It's like how to do vectorized SIMD instructions. So a lot of the sort of low-level operations, as we build the hash tables or as we do the RADx clustering, the partitioning, we can use SIMD to take a lot of data, load a lot of data into registers, and then invoke one instruction to apply whatever operation we want to apply and build our partition scheme or build our hash table very efficiently. So we'll talk about more about that later in the semester when we talk about vectorized execution. But for this, we completely sort of ignored that. But I think that would provide additional benefits over for the RADx stuff over the no partitioning case. And so any questions about parallel hash joins? Yes?
So in the starting of the build thing, you said that the build hash function you want should be different from the partition hash function that you use.
Yes.
So maybe it's not relevant for the minimum memory case, but if it's a NUMA architecture, then you would ideally want the build hash function to like do a more fine-grained partitioning, but like not move data to a different code, right? As in once you have partitioned using the partition function, you want to do a more fine-grained job, but you still want to keep the data in the same code.
So his question is, when you're doing partitioning, so let me jump back here. So in this case here, Right? It has to be multiple rounds, right? Let's do the radix one. So as I build this thing out, I'm using one hash function, right? And you're saying, when I come back for the second round, I want to make sure that I don't end up moving data from one core to the next.
Yeah,
or actually, you said the build phase, right?
Yeah, in the build phase.
Right, so but it's already partitioned. So every core is only looking at the data that's already local to it at its partition. So when you hash it, even though it's a different hash function, it's still not going to leave. It's not going to end up going to another core.
Irrespective of whatever hash function, if we take a completely random hash function in the second step, say the build step,
yes,
then it might lead to moving data around, right?
If not if you've already partitioned things, right?
Why?
Oh, when you say move data around, meaning like at hash table at another location?
Yeah, hash. All the cores will be using the same build hash function, right?
Yes.
And say it has a bucket 3.
Yes.
And it is possible that core 0's some value maps to bucket 3 and core 1's also maps to bucket 3.
Yes.
And if it's a new architecture and bucket 3 is on core 1, then you don't really want core 0 to have to map it to bucket 3, right? So the hash function, the second hash function should.
Yeah, so he's saying that I've always read that you want to do different hash functions from the partitioning phase to the build phase, or from the build phase from the partitioning phase. You're arguing that if you use the same hash function, then when you build the hash table, it might end up being stored in a memory location that's on the same core where it already is.
Yeah. Similar hash function with a more fine-grained.
What do you mean by more fine-grained?
Like the radixing. So in the first pass, in say the partitioning phase, you use the zero radix. In the build phase, you use the first radix. Something.
The problems if you use the same hash function or like the collisions.
Yeah.
You can get a more fine-grained thing here.
Then that's just another hash function.
Yeah.
There's like locality sensitive.
Yeah. That's a whole other thing I didn't talk about either. Right. This is just a purview. This is a high level overview of like, hey, you know, whatever, Java object hash. Is not the only thing in the world. There's other stuff, right? And the city hash stuff is people use in practice. We can talk about this offline. We can talk about this later, but in general, you have to use different hash functions because of collisions. Any other questions? Yes, in the back. The question is, can we talk about more about the scan and the BW tree? Okay, what's your question?
I don't know how to handle the scan in the delta end of the base page.
The question is, how do you do a scan in a BW tree with a delta chain and a base page?
Yes, because the delta chain is not modern. The key in the delta chain
is not modern. Scan is
the modern. Yeah, hold on. Yeah, so the question is, so say you're scanning the leaf nodes. It's not in order. You have to go, you know, say you're jumping along the leaves, right? Well, what would happen is you would end up always, when you jump from the logical pointer from one leaf to the next leaf, you would end up at the top of the delta chain, right? So in that case, you have to build a temporary buffer that's sorted of the values that you need that you could then emit. There's a little temporary storage you have to store.
So I have to buffer
the results. Yes. And then you have to be mindful, you have to keep track of, like, as you go down, like, if you see, because you're going in order in time, so you would ignore any deletes, right? If you see a delete for something that was inserted above it, then you just ignore it because you know that the insert came after it. But if you see a delete and you haven't seen anything above it, when you get to the leaf node, or actually, even below that, if you see that same key, you need to make sure you remove it. All right, so there's a little bookkeeping you have to do.
And the top of the results should be more.
Correct, yes. Because if the outside, like the thing outside the index expects to get stuff in a sorted order. In the back.
When we do the number, you have to decide the size of the node.
The question, so your question is what?
For the BW tree, when you do a split or merge,
Okay.
So do you decide it by scan the delta chain, or you maintain a variable about the size?
Your question is, when you do a consolidation, or when you do a split?
Split.
Your question is, when you do a split or merge, how do you decide what should the size of the node be? Should be the size, should be the same size as the amount of data you need to store in it, right?
Exactly. I mean, how do you decide it is the right point to do a split or merge?
How do you decide whether it's the right point to do a split or merge? This is some threshold.
Sorry?
Some threshold. The question is based on the number, the count of the number of items or the number of deltas. Yeah, it's like you. So, right. So you can have say you can say my page should store 10 items, right? And on like a B plus tree, as soon as you hit 10, you have to split. You can be a little loosey goosey, and I mean, I'm not gonna say what the right policy is, but you can let it go over a little bit by not too much though, and then you decide that you want to do your split that way. Right, so you just hard code my index should have X number of entries in a node, and those correspond to keys. When you go above that, then you have one of the threads decide to do a split.
So I can say that if the delta chain, the size of delta chain is arrive some point, I can do a split.
No, that's different. Right, I could have, your delta chain could be a million things of delete X, insert X, delete X, insert X, right? You still don't, that doesn't increase the number of keys you have.
I have to, every time, to know the size of this node, exactly.
You don't have to, but you could. Right? You could just scan and compare it. Yes?
So, one question is, data. So basically, data is like a linked list.
Yes.
So, and the reason we have data chain is we want to avoid implicit update.
Correct.
Because in medical environment, context, implicit method may result in catch condition, something like that.
Correct.
So, but the linked list, the one disadvantage of linked list is there's no locality.
Right.
So basically,
depends on how you implement it.
The implement?
Yeah.
You jump. So basically, it's very likely you just directly access memory.
What did I talk about today? I talked about, I'm not pointing to this. I talked about alpha buffers that had a bunch of tuples in it, right? You can implement your linked list that way. Spend a little extra, storage costs overhead, having some empty space, but then you chase less pointers. That's a low-level implementation detail that you should know how to do. Any questions? All right, next class, we'll do parallel sort merge join algorithms. I like these papers because there's at least three papers from three different groups of authors that always say sort versus hash joins revisited, right? So we'll cover that, and I think you guys are assigned to read one of those revisited papers. And then there's a large number of people that have been watching these videos that have been emailing me telling me to fuck off and other things like that. So we're going to spend some time addressing the hate mail to everyone out there on Monday. Okay? All right, guys. See you next class.